Welcome to Hindu Analysis, September 12, 2018. So the first article is Small Loans, Another Crisis in the Making. So recently, our former RBI Governor Raghuram Rajan, he submitted a report to MP's panel. In that, he stated that the next crisis in India's banking sector, that means what he is telling is, he is telling about the bad loans and the non-performing assets in the banking sector. So it will be majorly due to the loans given to MSEs via the Mudra loans, and second one is the Kishan credit card, and third one is the credit guarantee schemes for MSMEs. So because of these three smaller loans which is provided to the people, it will only trigger the future NPAs or future crisis in the India's banking sector. So how he is coming to this conclusion means, and on the basis of analysis, that nearly 6.37 lakh crore of loans is until now provided to the farmers and to the people through these three schemes. So this, if in case the government is planning to waive off these all these loans, or if the government is planning to give even more credit to the people, then it will surely going to result in the major crisis in the banking sector itself in the form of the non-performing assets. This is what he raised his concern, and also he warned that each and every time if government or if bank is going to give some credit to the people, then it should closely monitor the potential credit risk which is associated with that loan. And also the government should, as of now, it should refrain from setting ambitious credit targets to the people. That means it should not further give more credits, or it should not set higher credit targets to the people, as well as it should not, as of now, it should restrain from waiving off the loans to the people. So this is what he told. So he is our RBI Governor Raghuram Rajan. So as we said before, these three are the schemes which is providing the credit to the people. So the first one, so if you see in the order in which it is getting implemented, the first one is the Kishan credit card in the year 1998. And the second one is the credit guarantee scheme for MSME in the year 2000. And the third one is the Pradhan Mantri Mudra Yojana in the year 2015. So we are going to see all these things one by one. So the first one is the Kishan credit card. So it is by the collaboration of RBI and NABARD, and it is aiming to give the credits to the farmers with a limit of 50,000 rupees, and the repayment by the farmers can be done after the crops are harvested. So this is a special program which is aiming for farmers, which is mainly focused on the agriculture. Okay. And the second one is credit guarantee scheme for MSEs, which is the micro and small enterprises. They are getting a loan from 5 lakh to 10 lakh, which is collateral free loans. Okay, so it is implemented by the government and the SIDBI. So this is also a major important scheme. So the next one is the Pradhan Mantri Mudra Yojana. Mudra means Micro Units Development and Refinancing Agency. So all the MSE sectors, which are the micro and the small enterprises, for them, there should be some central agency to provide the money, right? So that central agency is this Mudra, okay? So this refinancing agency. So to give, if you give money to this Mudra, they distribute the money to the MSME sectors, okay? So this is mainly aimed for the financial support for the micro enterprises as well as the small enterprises, and it is for the purpose of funding to the non-corporate small business sectors. So in this scheme, the credit is available to the small businesses, startups or entrepreneurs, and it is open and available from all the branches of bank across the country, and its range is from 50,000 to 10 lakh rupees to start as well as to grow the businesses. And it is categorized as Shishu, Kishore and Tarun. Depend on which category you choose, you are getting the credit. So the next article is India's first missile tracking ship is readying for sea trials. So what the news here is, the Hindustan Shipyard Limited, it is now gearing up for the conduction of sea trials for this surveillance ship. So it is India's first missile tracking ship. As of now, it is not yet named. So it is named only after its induction into our Navy. So it is as of now called as VC-11184. Okay. So to whom they are actually doing this is for the purpose of National Technical Research Organization, which is the technical intelligence agency in our country, which is exclusively under the Prime Minister's office as well as the National Security Advisors. So if you see the specifications of this surveillance ship, then it is a 300 strong crew holding ship with high-tech gadgets as well as the communication equipments installed in it. And it is the first of its kind ocean surveillance ship in order to strengthen our country's strategic weapon programs. So this Hindustan Shipyard Limited, so it is not only doing that surveillance ship project, but it is also planning to do some future project. The first one is the construction of 5 fleet support ships, and the second one is the medium refit of Russia-made INS Sindhuratna. So this INS Sindhuratna is an attack submarine. So we all knew that the submarines are the potent weapons all over the world. So submarines means it is working under the sea. It is attacking the enemy targets by means of hiding under the sea, and it attacks the enemy target. So submarine, right? So it is prowled the oceans silently, and it is ready to attack the enemy's target at any point of time. So it is a potent weapon for any country. So if we see in this case, the submarines are classified into two types. One is the attack submarine and another one is the ballistic missile submarine. So if we see what is the difference between these two, then the attack submarine is hunting and destroying the target which is nearby. That means it is going under the sea, and if any enemy target comes near it, it will attack that. But if in case of ballistic missile submarine, it is attacking the enemy's target which is very far away, like it is launching the intercontinental ballistic missile over the enemy's target which is present in some other continent which is far away from them. So if you see the example of this attack submarine, it is Sindhugos class, which is we are in collaboration with Russia, and Shishumar class, which is we are in collaboration with German. Similarly, for example, the ballistic missile means it is Arihant class, and this Arihant class submarine is a nuclear powered one. So in this picture, it is the Sindhugos class, and this is INS Shishumar. So the next article is damage to Aravalli's Skerry. So what the content here is, the Supreme Court recently ordered for the demolition of the structures which are built illegally by any prominent builder in the protected forests area of Aravalli's. Because construction of the structures or construction of the projects by them is causing major ecological damage to the Aravalli's range. So as per the Punjab Land Preservation Act of 1992, they declared Aravalli's range as forest land and it is fragile. So they declared this. So whatever the construction which is happening after this declaration, it should be demolished. That is what the Supreme Court recently ordered. So the structures built after 1992 should be razed down within December 31st, 2018. So, and it also expressed concerns by stating the state, that is the whatever the state that the Aravalli's hills passing through, the state, town and country's planning department, it is very short-sighted and it is not even care about how much it costs to the environment. So this is a major concern, and also the state should be held responsible for its conflicting and self-destructive stand, which by means of providing the permission for the construction to the prominent builders. And they also stated that it is not only a major threat for the future generation, but it is also a major threat for the present generation, because now they are suffering from acute water shortage in these areas, because all the groundwaters which are available in those areas are made use by these people. So now there is an acute water shortage. So it all should be taken into consideration. That is what the Supreme Court stated. So if you see in this picture, this is Aravalli. Okay, so it extends from Delhi through Haryana and Rajasthan and ending in Gujarat. So the next article is Army mulling increasing retirement age of Jawans. So what here they are stating is the life expectancy has gone up in general since independence, and the soldiers are also relatively younger when they are retiring. So stating these, what they are telling is the Army is proposing to increase the retirement and the pensionable age of the Jawans who are in service from 15 years to 20 years. So currently they are, after the 15 years of service, they are getting retired, but the Army is now proposed to increase it to 20 years of service. So why? Because the first major thing is to reduce the pension burden for the Army. And if the pension burden is getting reduced, then that money can be utilized for the new purchases as well as the modernization of our Army. So this is the first major thing. And the second one is it is also providing longer tenure for the soldiers to serve, right? So these two are the advantages that they are stating why the service tenure from 15 years should be increased to 20 years. So the current revenue to capital ratio as of now is 83:17. So we are spending more than what we are actually accruing. So it has to be reached at least 65:35. It is what our country's target. But the ideal target should be like 60:40. So the next article is CRPF takes up mental health project. So what the news here is, the CRPF, which is our country's largest paramilitary force, so it is launching its first time project to ascertain Jawan's mental health, who are actually devoid of justice. So why they are actually doing this project means the more lives of troops are lost actually due to suicides as well as due to the stress factors than during the operation times, and it is nearly 15 times than that of the operation time. During the anti-Maoist activities, during the anti-terrorist activities or anti-insurgent activities, the soldiers are losing their lives. But when compared to the suicide and stress factors and heart attacks, which is putting pressure on them, it is very much lesser. That is, it is 15 times greater than during that time. So to ensure the better work-life balance for the troops and to counsel them, the AIIMS and the Tata Institute of Social Sciences, in collaboration with these soldiers, they are starting or launching this project. So usually where these CRPF, that is the soldiers, are deployed means mainly in three areas. One is the counter-terrorism in Jammu Kashmir. Second one is anti-Naxal operations in the left-wing extremism hit areas, particularly in the northeast areas. And the third one is counter-insurgency in the northeast. So we have seen before the paramilitary force, and among them only the CRPF is one of the force, right? So we have to understand what is the difference between normal military and the paramilitary. So this is army, navy and air force. These are all coming under general military, and the paramilitary is different, which means it is a subordinate to them. It is not equivalent to them. And all the three, army, navy and air force, are coordinately working with the paramilitary forces. So this is coming under defense ministry, but the paramilitary forces is coming under Ministry of Home Affairs. Okay, so this is the first major difference, and it is mainly for the purpose of border warfare and during the natural calamities time. So these are their deployment purposes, but the paramilitary purposes is for internal disturbances or insurgencies, border protection within the states, as well as election and the VIP protection. So these are the reasons why they are getting deployed. And if you see, for example, in case of military, it is Assam Rifles, SFF and Indian Coast Guard. These are all army or military kind of a thing. But paramilitary means the CRPF, BSF, CISF, SSB, these are all the paramilitary forces. So CRPF is one among the paramilitary forces. So what they actually demand from the government is timely career promotion, better infrastructure, separate ministry to take up the paramilitary needs, and the grievance redressal and the separate tribunal to deal their cases, and hardship allowance for their hard work. These are all their demands. But what as of now the government is planning to give them is some suggestions. One is the buddy system, which is one trooper in the paramilitary is responsible for another trooper's mental health as well as the physical health. So this is called the buddy system. So this is proposed by the government recently. The second one is the battalion commanders, that is the head of the team, they should frequently interact with their subordinates as well as with their team in order to ensure that everything is going fine, as well as that there is a work-life balance for the soldiers. And the proper counseling and the medical treatment should also be provided to them in a proper manner. So the next article is corruption costs $2.6 trillion, or 5% of the global GDP. So what the news here is, in a recent United Nations meeting which is focused on corruption, the United Nations Secretary General, he expressed his concern, stating at least $2.6 trillion, which is equivalent to 5% of the global GDP, it is circulated throughout the world mainly because of the corruption. So the corruption cost this much, this is what he expressed. And why? Because so he also added that the recent World Bank report that states the businesses and the individuals every year, they actually paying nearly $1 trillion as bribes. So this is very huge amount, right? So he's also adding this point, stating that these all could lead to this much amount of corruption cost. So whether it is rich or poor, north or south, developed or developing, anyone, but the corruption occupies or it is spread over everywhere. And why? Majorly because of the political dysfunctionality as well as the social disunity which is prevailing in the society, as well as he also stated that this corruption is very high in the areas which is heavily affected by the conflict. The area is already heavily affected by the conflict, but if there exists corruption, then it would ultimately lead to the, it affects the basic need itself, and it also exacerbate or increase the hunger and the poverty in that conflicted areas. And similarly, it also further led to, so if the basic needs are not available, then obviously it causes illicit trafficking of weapons, drugs, terrorism and extremism, which are the underground activities, right? So these are all the concerns he is stating because of the corruption, what it is prevailing in the country or in the world as of now. So what is the way forward here is, before and all, this United Nations is not focusing that much on corruption, but in this recent meeting, what they are stating is, we should seriously take the corruption issue as of now, and we should take the required steps as soon as possible, and we should ensure the transparency and the accountability in every action that is taking place in the world, and empower the citizens to do their part at the grassroots levels, as well as we have to build the capacity of national anti-corrupt commissions, and the punishment should be very stringent, and we should also ensure independent judiciaries in order to take stringent actions and make stringent laws, as well as we have to give more freedom to the media, and whistleblower protection should also be ensured, so in order to curb the corruption. So the next article is Supreme Court not to intervene in posting of DGP for Jammu and Kashmir. So what the news here is, the Jammu and Kashmir government on September 6 appointed Dilbar Singh as acting police chief as an interim measure, not as a permanent measure, but as an interim measure, and stating that there we have, that is in Jammu and Kashmir, we are facing some emergency circumstances such as upcoming Panchayat and local body elections, insurgent and terror related activities in JNK, as well as the unique law and order requirements which is always needed in Jammu and Kashmir. So due to all these emergency circumstances, we actually appoint an acting chief police as an interim measure until a regular appointment of police is made in consultation with UPSC. So as a temporary measure, we are actually appointing him. This is what the Jammu and Kashmir stated. So what is the background of this case is, the center before actually filed a case in Prakash Singh and NK Singh case. In that case, what the center actually stated is, certain states in India, they are actually appointing acting DGPs, then make them permanent just before their date of superannuation, which ultimately lead to the benefit of additional 2-year tenure till the age of 62 years for them. So why? Because mainly because of the favoritism and the nepotism of the political parties. So in order to curb that, the center actually put this case, which means, for example, consider if a police officer, he is going to retire at the age of 60, but just before 2 to 3 months of his retirement, if he is made into an acting DGP, then instead of retiring at the age of 60, now he is having an extended tenure till 62, right? So it is majorly based on the political influence as well as the favoritism and nepotism. So we have to curb this. So in order to curb this only, the Supreme Court actually prohibited this appointment of the acting DGP. Okay, but now the Jammu and Kashmir actually violated this. That is what the concern. So now the center is again putting the case to the Supreme Court, stating the Jammu and Kashmir is actually violating this. But the Supreme Court stated that actually now we are not going to intervene in this case until the proper appointment is made in consultation with the UPSC. So the next article is imitating to flatter. So what this article suggests is, the 2019 general election is very nearing, and now if we see our society, so what are the lawlessness which is very visible to the naked eye itself? That is what discussed clearly in this article. So the first major thing, so these lawlessness in the society is only keeping our country in a state of tension and conflict, right? So what are those things? What are those lawlessness? That is, the first one is the demonetization by the government. So if we see, means it is actually aimed at nullify or curb the black money and the counterfeit notes, but it is not actually achieved yet. And it actually in turn slowing down the economy and strangulating or destabilizing the cash dependent informal sectors, especially the MSME sectors itself. So this is the first thing. The second one is the GST system, which is a high compliance tax system. So there also, instead of high revenue, the revenue collected is very less. And the fuel prices, on the other hand, is very increasing because of the trade war or the global trade war. And the falling of the rupee, so the rupee is against the US dollar, it is also getting depreciated. So these are all represent how much tension or conflict which is present in our country as of now. So these only reflected in the recent protest by the farmers, industrial laborers and the unemployed youth all over the country. So whatever we are seeing before, that is economic tensions, right? So now we are going to see what are the social tensions. So the first one is the communal violence which is happening. It is not episodic. It is not happening then and there. It is now becoming a continuum. It is not having end at all. And the second one is the mob lynching which is happening all over the country, especially the dictatorship which is practiced by the mobs in the name of child lifters and cow vigilantism. And mainly it is targeted against Muslims and Dalits. So the third one is arrests of right activists, especially the activists who are supporting the Dalits and the Adivasis, they are actually putting under some unproven charges and they are getting arrested. So these are all representing the social tensions which is prevailing in the society. Especially what is the major concern here is these social tensions are now becoming a very new normal. So we are not treating it differently. Now we consider this as a new normal and we are used to it. So these are all the major concerns. So what is the conclusion here is the civil society should come forward and they should be louder in expressing their concern if at all their democracy is violated, or if at all there is a threat to their democracy, they should be very louder and they should express their concerns. So the next article is encouraging young minds. So what is the news here is recently Indian origin mathematician Akshay Venkatesh. So he got prestigious field medal, which is Nobel Prize for math. Okay. So it is a very proud moment, but on the same time it also raised a question that why has our Indian education system not produced any field medalist, especially when there is a lot of talent. So we are having more pool of talent, but even though we are having that much talent, why we are not producing any field medalist? Mainly because the opportunities and the trainings that these talents receiving is very meager. So this is what a major concern, right? So it is also added that the All India Survey on Higher Education Data, it stated that nearly 36.6 million students are enrolled every year for higher education. But in that much amount of student, only 36.4% are joining the science and the humanities stream. So it is somewhat good amount. But among the 36.4% of humanities and science students, the students who are getting trained under the proper way or under a qualitative way is very meager. So one such program which is ensuring the quality program or quality education to the students is Mathematics Training and Talent Search of 1993. It actually trained the students in mathematics field and it also making them to compete in Mathematics Olympiad, but yet this is not that much up to the level. So these are all the concerns stated towards the lack of talent or lack of opportunities for the young talents which are thriving in our country. So if you see in case of other countries, especially France and US, they are actually boast of their field medalists. They are actually having nearly 3000 to 4000 scientists and they are getting nearly 12 to 15 medals and all. But in our country it is very meager, right? So what we should do forward is there should be a healthy educational ecosystem which provide enough space for the young minds, for their abstract mathematical and scientific ideas to get explored. As well as there should be a balanced network of universities, education system in with the help of the teachers, and most importantly, a solid base foundation in their school education itself. So these are all the way forward to ensure that much level of achievement in the any field, including the science and humanities field. So the next article is Supreme Court orders status quo on RBI's February 12 circular. So what the news here is, the RBI's February 12 circular actually mandated the insolvency proceeding for the debt default beyond 180 days. So we all knew about this IBC and FRDI. So this FRDI is for dealing the cases or dealing the default cases related to financial corporations like banking, etc., banks and all. And this IBC, which is the insolvency and the bankruptcy code, this is mainly for the purpose of non-financial corporations or the institutions. So what the mandate under this IBC is, if any corporation is not going to solve the debt, or it is going to default, or it is going to default after it is exceeding its limit after 180 days, then the insolvency and the bankruptcy court should come and started its proceeding. So this is what the mandate under the IBC. But what the recent news here is, though the power firms in our country, it is reaching its limit, that means it is crossing the limit of 180 days. So what the Supreme Court recently stated is, don't commence any insolvency proceedings against the power firms as of now, and it just postponed it to here in November. Why? Because the debt or the default which is made by the power firms, it is not due to the internal factors, it is mainly due to the external factors. One is the non-availability of the resources, especially the coal. It is mainly needed for the production of power for the power firms, right? But it is not at all available. So this is one external factor. The second one is not getting proper revenue from the power DISCOMs. So the power distribution companies, they are also not giving the revenue properly to the power firms. So these two external factors only led to the default by the power firms recently. So as they are not internal problem, we should not deal these cases as of now. We should allow them to continue as of now, and we should hear it in November. So this is what the Supreme Court recently stated. So if you see, nearly 1.7 lakh crore of stressed assets is with banks for the power firms. Okay. So the last article is avoidable suspense on Indian origin FPIs. So recently we knew about the case that the SEBI has put forward some norms stating that the NRIs, the OCIs and the PIOs, if they are having any investment in India, then they are not the owner or they are not the beneficial owner itself. And they're also putting some threshold like 10%, 20%, 30%, etc. Right. So these norms, these SEBI norms, raising major concern mainly towards the FPI investors. So the FPI investors as well as AMRI, who are the Asset Management Roundtable of India, they both raised the concern towards the SEBI norm, stating that if it is going to get implemented, then nearly $75 billion of investment, whatever present in India as of now, is that means it is going to get withdrawn. So for that, again, the SEBI actually constituted a committee, which is the HR Con committee. So this HR Con committee, which is constituted by SEBI itself, they now put forward some new suggestions, so which is giving more relief to the FPI investors. So the first one is the NRIs, OCI card holders and the resident Indians can manage the investment if that FPI is registered with SEBI. So if you are registered with SEBI, then you are having the access to the investment here, as well as the majority. That is, earlier the term majority is very vague, but now they mentioned if you are having 50% of FPI asset, then you are the majority. So they clearly stated in this new suggestion, which is giving a major relief to the FPI investors. And the second one is 180 days to unwind their position. For example, they are putting some thresholds like 10%, 20%, 15%. But if some investor is having more than that, if he is having some 30 or 40%, then now they are providing with more than 180 days in order to achieve that new threshold. Okay. So the third one is to achieve all these targets, the deadline is extended from August 31st to December 31st. So these are all based on the conclusion that treating all the FPIs with Indian origin, like this NRIs, OCIs, PIOs, as illicit money people. So this is unwise, right? Mainly why the SEBI is putting this norm is to curb the black money, to curb the money laundering, as well as to avoid the round tripping. So treating all these NRIs, OCIs as money laundering people is not wise. So we have to deliberately look into it, and we have to make the suggestion, and we should implement this. This is what the HR Con committee recently stated. Thank you.